Very good morning and welcome to the 25th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. We have apologies from Marie McNair and we welcome Stephanie Callaghan, who is attending as her substitute. So our first item of business today is to invite Stephanie to declare any relevant interests.
Thank you, Convener. I have no interest to declare.
Thank you, Stephanie. Can I ask if anyone else has any register of interests?
Convener, just for item 2 and 3 of the agenda, just to put on the record that I am receipt of PIP.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks, Jeremy. Okay, our second item of business is the consideration of a Scottish statutory instrument, the Carer's Assistance, Carer Support Payment, Consequential and Miscellaneous Amendments and Transitional Provision, Scotland Regulations 2023. This instrument is subject to negative procedure. Its purpose is to make consequential and miscellaneous amendments and transitional provision in connection with the introduction of carer support payment, which will replace carer's allowance in Scotland. Do members have any comments on the instrument? I'm going to invite the committee then to agree that it does not wish to make any further recommendations in relation to this instrument. Are members content to note the instrument? Thank you. Before we move on, I'm going to suspend proceedings until we have the cab sec with us for the next agenda item. Thank you. Welcome back. Next this morning is the consideration of an affirmative statutory instrument, the Disability Assistance Miscellaneous Amendment Scotland Regulations 2023. The instrument is laid under the affirmative procedure, which means the Parliament must approve it before it comes into force. I welcome to the meeting Shirley Ann Somerville, Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice. I also welcome her officials, Oliver Wayne, Policy Manager, Disability Benefits Policy, Social Security Directorate, and Madeline McPhail, Solicitor, Scottish Government. And thank you for joining us today. A few points to mention about the format of the meeting before we actually get started. There is, I believe, a member online, James Dornan. So if he's coming in, please allow our broadcasting colleagues a few seconds to turn his microphone on before we start to speak. And can I ask everyone to keep questions and answers as concise as possible? Following this evidence session, the committee will be invited in the upcoming agenda items to consider a motion to approve this instrument. I remind everyone that Scottish Government officials can speak under this item, but not in the debate that follows. I'm now going to invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a short opening statement.
Thank you very much and good morning, Convener. As with all our social security benefits, dignity, fairness and respect has been embedded throughout the process of developing both child and adult disability payment. The journey between these benefits is already well established and the regulations before committee today will further improve on client experience on this journey. We have extended eligibility for child disability payment to age 18 years, and this is to ensure the continuity for young disabled people and their families. We have been told that this can be a very difficult transition period in a young person's life, and that's why we introduced this key point of difference to the DWP system. These regulations will build on the existing improvements by protecting payment dates for young people moving to adult disability payment. This provides financial continuity, reduces the risk of gaps in payment or overpayments, and eases their transition from one form of assistance to another. It is worth noting that no such protection of payment dates is currently available in the DWP system. We're also making sure that where people will get more money when they move to adult disability payment, the process is fully aligned with the policy intent while delivering consistency and fairness across different client groups. We have safely and securely transferred the disability benefit awards of well over 97,000 people living in Scotland. We continue to do so in line with our case transfer principles. No one has to reapply. People continue to be paid the right amount at the right time. Since the launch of adult disability payment, no one has been required to start a process that would subject them to a DWP-style face-to-face assessment. We are completing transfer as soon as we can while ensuring the process remains safe and secure. And we are communicating clearly with people throughout so they know what's happening with their benefit and when. We are taking this opportunity to clarify and improve some of the case transfer provisions that support this process. For example, where a person's award is transferred from DWP, we recognise any existing appointee pending a review by Social Security Scotland. We are clarifying that a separate review does not need to take place if the person has already been appointed by Social Security Scotland for the purposes of a different Scottish benefit. We're clarifying that Social Security Scotland can stop the transfer process if someone moves out of Scotland to another part of the United Kingdom after their case has been selected for transfer, but before the transfer completes. This means they can stay on their existing award and they do not have to reapply to the DWP after they move. And finally, people whose awards transferred to child disability payment currently continue to be eligible until they are age 19. This was meant to ensure young people turning 18 close to the time adult disability payment launched had enough time to apply. The proposed amendments limit this extension to those turning 18 before the end of the year, which is fairer and a better prioritisation of resources. We have engaged with the Scottish Fiscal Commission, who have confirmed that they anticipate no material financial implications on spending for the Scottish Government as a result of these regs. This is particularly welcome in this challenging fiscal period, given they offer further improvements for the people of Scotland at no increased cost. I'm committed to continually improving public services for the people of Scotland, and these regulations allow us to provide clarity and further improve people's experiences. Taking such opportunities is a founding principle of social security in Scotland, and these regs before you today evidence my unending commitment to continuous improvement. I would also like to extend my thanks to the Scottish Commission on Social Security for their formal scrutiny of the draft amendments earlier this year and for their recommendations, which have strengthened the detail of the regulations before us today. And I welcome this opportunity to assist the committee in its consideration of these regulations and, of course, happy to provide any additional information as required.
Okay, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. We will now move on to questions, and our questions will be directed to yourself. But you are, of course, welcome to invite any official to respond, should you wish to do so. So I am going to start off with a question myself, and it's more of a general one, really, and it's how you could maybe highlight the fundamental sort of differences between the DWP and Social Security Scotland as well. And I know that you know, CERD fees have been carried out as well in terms of the benefits that are devolved now here to Scotland and what the findings have been.
Well, we have at every avenue endeavoured to ensure that we are working with those with lived experience to provide a benefit system that is not simply fit for purpose but provides dignity, fairness and respect at every opportunity. And that's a very important aspect of what we're trying to do, and again, seeing social security as a human right. It's important, therefore, that we not only look at how we introduce our benefits, but also how they work in practice, and the regulations today are an example of how we can continue to improve. Although I am pleased to see that the recent evidence through, for example, the client experience surveys that Social Security Scotland publish have shown a high level of satisfaction with the process of application, with the level of support that people get to fill in that application. And that's why we're determined, yes, to continue to improve, but to take pride in the fact that those with experiences of the DWP have helped us shape a system which is markedly different to their experiences that they've had previously.
OK, thanks very much. That's really helpful. I believe Katie Clark would like to come in.
Thank you. Statistics have previously shown that people in Scotland are waiting longer for their adult disability payment decision from Social Security Scotland than people in England and Wales who have applied for the personal independence payment through the DWP. The average wait time for adult disability decision is around 19 weeks compared to 9 weeks for the personal independence payment decision. That's double. I mean, the wait time's doubled over the last year. What steps are Social Security Scotland taking to reduce these waiting times?
So if I can perhaps urge some caution when making comparisons, and I'll give one example about why the situation is very different. Members of the committee will be well aware that under DWP, when you're applying for PIP, it is the customer, as it is called down south, who are obligated to find their supporting information and present that. That is one of the areas which is one of the greatest stressors and one of the greatest areas of concern within the system that they have within DWP. Within Social Security Scotland, there is no obligation for the client to be able to have to do that, and it is the agency who will take that obligation on board. Now, that does therefore mean that it will take time for the agency to get that supporting information from a profession. That could be a GP, it could be a supporting nurse or someone out with the health sector. But if you are looking at comparisons, it is very important to realise the amount of work the client has to put in before applying to PIP to get that supporting information, whereas under Social Security, that is not the case, and that does take time. So, for example, letters have to go out to a GP, and then that information has to come back in. In saying that, though, I'm very well aware that people are waiting too long for child disability payments and adult disability payments, which is why there's been a number of measures being put in place right the way through the client journey to see what can be done to improve that. And I am satisfied that the improvements are making a difference. Now, that will have to show up in the statistics as they are published, but there's a great deal of work, and I believe that David Wallace has spoken to committee about some of the detail of that. I could go on with more examples, convener, about how it's changed straight from what's in an application form to our work with stakeholders, about how the support and information is gathered, to our ability for our client advisers to look at that within the system and work within Social Security Scotland to try and bring things to a resolution quickly. And one of the other important aspects is that we are the agency has given clients a number of opportunities to, for example, provide us with the details of who to get supporting information from, and that gives the client a number of opportunities to be able to feed into the system. That also takes time if, for whatever reason, the client is not responding to information that's coming out and requests that's coming out from the agencies. So One, I would urge caution about direct comparisons, but I do absolutely recognise that work needs to be done. It is and will continue to be done.
I hope the Cabinet Secretary will accept that the wait times are unacceptably long. They're more than double that in England and Wales, and that cannot be something that we should accept. Would she agree with that?
They are not double because you cannot compare. They are not a like-for-like comparison.
I think you've explained that, Cabinet Secretary. So you have made that very, very clear about the differences
exactly.
in the system. But for the person waiting for their money, that isn't an acceptable position, is it?
Well, that's exactly why it's important to reassure clients that the money, their funds, will be backdated to the point of application. And what you have seen, and I would point members to the work that's been done through the client surveys, which has shown that those people who are going through the process are satisfied that they're being supported through that application process, and they are finding that a very, very different system. So I hope Ms Clark is also not suggesting that we should learn from the DWP and take part on their work examples of making sure that the client has that responsibility and therefore the stress. Now, if that's what she wants, a like-for-like system, then you can have like-for-like comparisons. But I very much did say in my original remark that the waiting times are unacceptable, and that's exactly why there's a lot of work going on.
So we also know that Social Security Scotland's own figures for May 2023 that show that 40% of all applications for adult disability payment were rejected, whilst this is slightly lower than the average 47% rejection rate for personal independence payment across the UK. It is extremely high rejection rate. Has the government identified the factors that need to be addressed to reduce this high rejection rate, and has she got an explanation as to why rejection rates are so high?
So it is very important to support people through the system, and that's why we have, for example, local delivery within there, to be able to support people through the application. It then needs to go through a decision-making process to analyse it against eligibility criteria and to make a decision. Now, I think the other important aspect of this is to point to the number of appeals, which are very small, and the number of reconsiderations, which again are very small, which does point to the fact that there are, again, a great difference between what happens in the DWP and what happens within Social Security Scotland about the agency getting the decision right first time. Now, if anyone who has had a refusal has concerns about that and wishes to seek redetermination and appeal, they are given that information directly when they get the letter through. So, of course, we have to have a system that supports. We then have to have a system that makes a strong eligibility-based decision. And then we support people to go through processes of appeals if that's required. And I think the committee can take heart in the fact that the number of redeterminations and appeals is exceptionally low compared to the figures within the DWP, which once again demonstrates that we're getting the decision right first time in so many more cases than was the case within the DWP. Now, of course, because it's a new system, there will inevitably be monitoring and evaluation which goes on to ensure that we have a system that is fair and that the decisions are being made. And of course, that's part of the monitoring and evaluation process that the committee would go through. Now, I understand the committee has had an outstanding invitation to go up to the headquarters for some time for Social Security Scotland, and I'm sure the agency would be delighted to take you through that in greater detail when the committee finds time to do so.
Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. And yeah, we are still looking at dates in terms of heading up to Dundee for that visit. So, yep, thank you. So, I believe, Katie, do you want to come back in?
Are you... Just very briefly. So, as I understand it, the young people continue to get child disability payment for a short period after they turn 19 if their adult disability payment is decided within 4 weeks of their 19th birthday. However, the wait times are currently longer than that. It's longer than 4 weeks. Can you just give reassurances in terms of what happens to those individuals that are transferring from the child disability payment to adult disability payment?
So we're very confident that we have systems in place to be able to ensure that there's no gap in payment. And if I can give some examples, convener, of how that can happen. Of course, an individual can apply very close to the deadline of 18th birthday, but the agency ensures that there are a number of letters, including the details of how that young person can be supported, that go through. So that happens to ensure that we provide support to people way before that cut-off. Now, if we're getting to the stage where they are in any danger of reaching a deadline of support, that's why the operational systems will kick in within the agency to recognise that and ensure that decisions can be made before that deadline happens. So it's not just the fact that we spend a great deal of time trying to encourage and support people through, but once we do feel that there's a hard stop potentially coming that might impact on an individual, the system can spot that, the client advisors can step in, and then work can be done to make sure that that is sped up and allocated the urgency that it would absolutely require at that stage.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I believe Jeremy would like to come in.
Thank you, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary, and good morning to your team. Cabinet Secretary, I do feel there's a slight putting your head in the sand here. So I appreciate we can all quote cases, but you know, I have a constituency at the moment who applied in June. It wasn't looked at until September, and at that point they were asked to go and get the evidence, not the Social Security Scotland. And I appreciate Twitter is not the place for everything, but if you look at the number of comments that have been put on Twitter about people's personal experience, it's not how you are recording it today. And I do think there is a real issue in regard to the length of time. Now, I appreciate it is a different way of doing it, but I think for us simply to say we're perfect, DWP are rubbish, is actually doing a disservice both to DWP, but actually is not the experience of many people that I'm coming into contact. And my question is, what conversations are you having with Social Security Scotland? Not just to get the story they want to tell you, but actually to get what real individuals' experience is. Because I think we're all getting now casework of people who are saying, I am getting a very negative experience from Social Security Scotland. Now, we want it to work, but it won't work if people are getting that negative experience.
So, can I very gently push back Mr Balfour a little bit? I did absolutely in no way say that everything is perfect and people should back off from scrutiny, because I think I recognise on a number of occasions that the waiting times are unacceptable for processing, and that's why a number of pieces have been worked. So if you forgive me, I'll push back a wee bit on that part. I'm happy to look at the individual case should Mr Balfour wish to pass that on, and we're very keen to do so to make sure that we're learning from particular cases. Again, I would urge the committee to be able to take up the opportunity to go to Dundee to look at this in great detail, because there is an extraordinary amount of work that has been done and is continuing to be done to improve the systems, the processes and the handling that's in place. And that has been ongoing for many months now. And we are seeing the benefit of that. I'm confident of that. But of course, that will take time to find its way through, because we still have cases that have been waiting too long at this exact time that are still needing a decision to be taken. And of course, it will take time, some things, for processes to change. But there have been a number of changes made already, for example, to application forms, and for example, to the way that cases are being dealt with within the agency. Another improvement we've also seen is call waiting times, which I know the committee was very concerned about. And I'll give two examples why, and I think Mr Balfour's loaned me for long enough now that I don't take anybody's word for it at face value, and I will look into things very seriously. So, of course, I meet very regularly with senior leaders within the agency and within programme to go through this. But I'm also very conscious of ensuring that we look at the client the client surveys which are coming through, which are statistically sound about what people's experiences are, and also very importantly speaking directly to stakeholders and to individuals themselves. Glasgow Disability for Alliance, for example, I've met with individuals affected by cancer that have had a poor experience with the agency, and we are very, very keen to learn from that, right from ministers all the way through to everyone who works in Social Security Scotland, who is determined to provide the type of service that we have spoken about in some times. So I hope I can provide them with reassurance that I do take this very seriously. I don't just take the word off, with great respect to my officials, on this. The work that we're doing with stakeholders is very, very important. There is a number of changes that have already been put in place, and we are seeing changes. So I will never be complacent about this. I know there is a great deal of work that still needs to be done. And if committee, under further investigation after visits to Dundee and discussions with agency staff, feel there's more that could be done on this, we will happily take further advice. The examples today, although technical for these regulations, are demonstrations of how we are committed to looking at continuous improvement. Now, these aspects around today are technical reg amendments, but we are also looking at continuous improvement within our systems, within the way that we as individuals handle this, both in government and in the agency.
That's helpful, thank you. I wonder if I can just take one clarification. Myself and the Deputy Convener, when in my previous term, I had a very helpful visit down to Victoria Quay, where we saw how the whole system was being designed before it was up and running, and I think both myself and Deputy Convener have been to Dundee previously. In regard to these changes that are being made, in regard to application form, is that being made by officials in Scottish Government, or is it being made by the agency themselves? So where does that responsibility lie for changes that are being made now?
So it's working, as I hope committee would expect, as part of a cohesive team, because you're quite right, Mr Balfour, some of these responsibilities will be with Scottish Government, some will be within agency, which is why we're not sitting in two different meetings, having two different discussions, but we're together collegiately looking at where things need to be done, for example, in programme, which technically sits within Scottish Government, and that will be changes to the systems that are actually happening, or changes, for example, to the guidance that's used by staff, and that would be something that would be delivered within the agency. But that's why we're all working together as one team on this, rather than it being an agency issue or a government issue. Of course, within that, each action point has lead officials that are looking at it, but it will very much vary depending on what action that is.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm now going to invite Bob Doris in. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, I find those exchanges very helpful. The focus has been on what supports are available for applicants, where there's issues, how those issues are addressed and improved, and quite rightly how that compares to the DWP and the rest of the UK, all really important things we should do consistently on this committee, drawing that comparison between Scotland and the rest of the UK. We want our system to be as modern and progressive and dignified and effective as possible. So I think it's absolute right to do that kind of scrutiny. So with that in mind, can I ask how young people who get child disability payment are being supported with their applications for adult disability payment? But also, can you contrast that with the young person's experience here in Scotland under this system compared to what it would be if they lived elsewhere in the UK?
So I've perhaps mentioned some of this in previous answers, so I'll try not to repeat myself for the sake of time, Convener, because I know I've talked for probably too long already. One of these aspects, which is one of the key differences, is of course that ability to have CDP up until 18. And that is a hugely important change that we brought in, as I said in my opening remarks, because it was recognised as a key stressful time for individuals. Now, that in some ways complicates the system, because there's not a hard cut-off point and people can make a decision to move, but that's important because it's the right decision for them rather than the right decision for the system. As I mentioned earlier, there's a number of pieces of correspondence, for example, which will go out to an individual, letting them know about that transition phase, and also very importantly having the details of where they can seek support. So another key difference is the local delivery staff that we have within Social Security Scotland. that provide support in filling out application forms. That's not available within the DWP system, and that's an important support mechanism for it. We also, of course, have advocacy services, an independent advocacy service that's available for people as well, not just from CDP-ADP, that's, of course, available wider than that too, to make sure that we can not just provide support within the system, but that advocacy, which is clearly very different to support to filling in applications, is provided. You also then have the signposting to independent welfare rights and advice services that again will give that reassurance that an individual is not alone, what can be a very difficult time for them, and they're also transitioning into adult services in a number of different ways at that point. So hopefully that gives examples of, yes, how it's different, but also how we can provide that different support at different points within an individual's journey from CDP to ADP.
That's very helpful, Cabinet Secretary. Can I just check, Convener, the support and filling out application forms not currently available within the UK system, is there an advocacy service within the UK system, and does that signposting mechanism happen within the UK system? The reason for asking that question is to draw out the comparisons and the contrasts, but also, if it does exist, how do we make sure the quality of our service is as it should be? So where are the benchmarks we can compare that with?
I'm not aware of there being an advocacy system, although I'm happy to clarify that in writing. Sure. If it does exist. So I'll happy to clarify that later on if there is indeed an independent advocacy service that's advised to clients for them to use. And the way that we ensure that this is working is, again, I go back to the fact that we need to make sure that we're asking people that are going through the system itself how they are experiencing it, and did it work for them? And that's a key part of the way we developed the system initially, but also now that we have our own system, what do they think of that system, and is it working for them, and do further improvements need to be made?
Okay, thank you.
Okay, I'm now going to invite Paul O'Kane. Thanks.
Thank you, Convener. And like the Deputy Convener, I think helpful exchanges there and covered a lot of ground in terms of my interest. But I think maybe just as a further point of information and clarity on transitions for young people, particularly young people with a learning disability. At 18, that is obviously a crucial point in young people's lives in terms of their transitions more generally. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what interaction Social Security Scotland has had with third sector support organisations who are helping young people at that point in their life with all of their transitions to really focus specifically on their application to move to ADP?
Well, this is a very key point that we need to ensure that we're working with stakeholders. So it's great. We've got a local delivery system. There's aspects in place. We're also very conscious that there are trusted organisations, people that folk will be working with within their family setting, and they may wish to go to them for support and guidance. And that's why, as with all of the work that we undertake within the government and the agency, there's a great deal of stakeholder work that goes on that explains the differences that regulations will make and the impact that can have, and also the support that's available for them. So we are now getting to the point where I think there is this process from CDP to ADP has been in for some time now, a reasonable amount of time. We are seeing a good level of feedback from the third sector about the support that's provided. But again, there's no complacency in that because it is very difficult. So one of the key points we'll be picking up, for example, if committee passes these regulations through Parliament, is to again make sure that we're going back out to stakeholders to explain any changes, any differences, and reassure around some of those areas as well.
Thank you. Do you think that there is more we could do in terms of streamlining the process and, I suppose, making it more passported or automated, or, you know, in terms of just knowing who these people are, knowing when their birthday is going to occur, you know, and just trying to make that a far more automatic process, given that often conditions at that stage in life haven't changed, the evidence perhaps hasn't changed considerably. But also, I think just in terms of that wider piece, and we know that there's legislation before Parliament and a private member's bill about transitions, you know, whether we can do everything possible to make transitions more broadly easier.
So again, it's a really important point about what we can automate and what we can make easier, not necessarily the same thing there. The challenge with CDP to ADP in making that a fully automated process, of course, is the eligibility criteria are completely different. So it is exceptionally, well, it is impossible to just make an assumption from what is there from a CDP case and immediately transfer that and make assumptions to ADP. In saying that, so you can't automate, but in saying that, what then can we do to make that transition easier for that individual to ensure that we're making it as simple as possible? So the change will still have to be there from one to the other, and that's been embedded since we agreed the regs for CDP and ADP, that they did have a different eligibility. But there are a number of ways where I think we are making it easier, but again, very, very keen to make sure that we're doing everything we can. If there's anything that's coming through in lived experience now that the systems are in place, whether it's in the regs or whether it's in the way that we work, to make that easier for people. And I think that's maybe at the stage that we're at rather than full automation.
Thank you, Kavira.
Thanks very much. I'm now going to invite Jeremy Balfour in.
Thank you, Convener. Just in regard to the monitoring side, will Social Security Scotland monitor the number of individuals who get a different level of award on ADP than we receive when we were on CDP?
So if you forgive me, Mr. Balfour, I'm not quite understanding the question because of one of the points I've just made to Mr. O'Kane, that there's different eligibility. So you can't exactly compare because there's different eligibility. In saying that, though, and I hope I can reassure him still, even though I'm saying there's different eligibility, so there are differences, perhaps, to awards. There is work that is in place within Social Security Scotland that does monitor and evaluate the individuals that move from CDP to ADP. So those individuals can be spotted within the system, they can be tracked within the system, and any differences that do happen in terms of awards, money that's going forwards, can actually be monitored. So while there will be differences because of eligibility, we are still doing absolutely everything we can to monitor that, evaluate it, and look at the awards that somebody got within CDP, the award that they're getting within ADP, to see whether there's any fluctuations, any changes, anything that's concerning within the numbers that are coming through.
No, I totally understand that, but I suppose what I'm looking for from a committee perspective is, will we be able to, in 2 years' time, say there were X number of children who got CDP, and then as they were transferred, X number of people now get ADP. Now, I understand it's a different for you, but will there be that monitoring that will be open to scrutiny to say either they went higher or lower? But I suppose my concern is that there seems to be a lack of data collection going on within Social Security Scotland, so it's very difficult to monitor some of that. So what I'm seeking to know is, I appreciate it's a different criteria, but will we be able to see the numbers clearly in black and white?
I don't think there is an issue with a collection of data on here, because management information will be able to link people that have moved from CDP to ADP. So we will be able to see, for example, differences in awards levels, any gaps in payment changes that have happened, which have meant we haven't quite got this system right. So I think there is the data collection, the monitoring evaluation that is in place that will be able to flag up to point to exactly the concerns that you've raised there, and for us then to be able to see what needs to be done to rectify that. So I'm confident that data collection is already in place.
And will that be publicly published?
I am unsure whether that's in the official statistics. I'll get back to the committee on that, but it's information that, we will be able to provide, I'm sure.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm now going to invite Ros McCallan. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I think you've alluded to this in bits, but how can Social Security Scotland help young people and their families understand how other benefits and payments might change as they move from CDP to ADP?
So, again, this points to one of those transition challenges that people will have. And the difficulty, of course, is the complexity of any benefit system. And this isn't a dig at the DWP, but any benefit system is complex. To ensure that people are at least cognizant of the fact that a change from CDP to ADP may mean changes in other benefit entitlements, passporting benefits and so on. And that varies so much from individual to individual. So there's a role for the agency, as I said, as the letters are going out to signpost to independent services to be able to allow those independent services to advise an individual on this. So you may, for example, get someone who would receive a higher award on CDP than they would on ADP, and that could be completely vice versa for somebody different. So it has to be person-centred. That has to be done, as I hope committee would understand, out with the agency, because once you apply for a benefit, you have applied and that process has begun. And once once the agency makes a decision on somebody's application, that decision is made. So that's why it's important that before we get to the point of them making that application, that they know what support's out there, they know the advice services that are out there, and they can work with that advice services so that they are guided through the challenges and the implications and the complexities that people may not be aware of, particularly if it's the first time they're going through that process of moving on to adult benefit system.
Thank you. It was alluded to. I appreciate that. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm now going to invite Stephanie Callahan.
Thanks very much, Convener, and thanks. Very informative already this morning. So I'm interested in the transfer from Disability Living Allowance to Personal Independent Payment, or ADP. And some people who have had a change of circumstance that occurs during the transfer process, they've told DWP about it, but it hasn't been taken into account in their DLA or their PIP award. So we have heard from stakeholders that the process hasn't always worked as intended, and you'd mentioned trusted organisations earlier on. So they say, Enable, for example, said that they've got a small number of cases that have been passed between DWP and Social Security Scotland where the claimant's unclear who it is that should be taking responsibility for it. So I'd be really interested in what Social Security Scotland are doing to ensure that clients and the staff as well are clear about how changes circumstances are reported during that transfer process.
So information for the case transfer process, including where to report changes circumstances, is set out clearly in the letters to clients during that process, including the initial welcome letter. It's also, of course, been discussed at stakeholder events as well, and it is very much there on the case transfer sheets which the agency staff use. It is, I think, a very important aspect as well that we have within our transfer process, the aspect that if clients are in receipt of DLA and PIP and they report a change of circumstance, that they are then moved to adult disability payments so they don't have to go through a DWP face-to-face assessment. Now, I do recognise that some people have had the difficulties that Ms Callahan mentions. Some of this will hopefully be assisted through the regulations that are going through today, but also there's clearly an amount of work that's already going on within the agency and within the DWP to make sure every single staff member in both agencies is absolutely cognisant of what should happen during the case transfer process and how anything should be dealt with. Now, over 97,000 people have had their awards transferred, so the case transfer process is overall successful. But again, I recognise that there are issues around the management of some cases, the examples of which you've given, which demonstrate it's not working for everybody. And on that reason, that's why some of the regs are here today. That's why there's work going on, not just within the agency, but also within the DWP, because it's important that, in effect, regardless of where you phone up, you're getting the same information about how your change of circumstance is dealt with. And there is a great deal of good work that goes on between the agency and the DWP to ensure that the same information is being given to clients regardless of where they phone. Now, as I say, that's not to take away from the fact that there have been individual cases where that has not worked as it should have done, but that's why there's a lot of work within the regs and within the work with staff to make sure that that is something that happens regardless of where you phone, you get the same information.
Okay, thank you. Just to be really clear on it, and I do apologise for getting that first bit mixed up when I was talking about moving to adult disability payment there. Just to be really clear then, it's clearly been monitored, and are you feeling confident now that actually that's really improving, that we're making progress on it?
Yes, I do. I do think we've made progress on that. The case transfer process was always going to be one of the most challenging aspects, but it needs to work for every single person as we go through that process. And that's why there's a great deal of work that's been going on, say, not just within the agency, but very closely and very collegiately with the DWP on this issue, because it may be either with an agency or within the DWP that hasn't been handled correctly, and they need to work together and are working together to ensure that those situations don't happen.
Thanks, that's very helpful. Thanks, Convener.
Okay, thank you very much. And I think that concludes our questions, and we're moving on to agenda item 4. So agenda item 4 is the formal consideration of motion S6M10409, that the Social Justice and Social Security Committee recommends that the Disability Assistance Miscellaneous Amendment Scotland Regulations 2023 draft be approved. I invite the Cabinet Secretary to speak and move this motion.
Moved, Convener.
I now invite contributions from any of the members. Okay. I now invite the committee to agree that it does not wish to make any further recommendations in relation to this instrument. Are members content to note the instrument? Okay, thank you very much. Now moving on to... I now invite the Cabinet Secretary to sum up and respond to the debate.
Nothing to add, Convener.
Okay, thank you. The question is that motion S6M10409 in the name of Shirley Ann Somerville be approved. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Okay. And that concludes that agenda item 4. Thank you. Can I just thank the Cabinet Secretary and thank our officials as well. And that concludes our public business today. We'll now move into private to consider the remaining items on the agenda. Thanks very much.